welcome to the Scary Basement Jump Scare. Each month, me and my friend Roxy find ourselves suddenly and jarringly back in the horrifying scary basement, and we are never ready for it. I'm Mikey McCollor, and I was in the middle of taking out the trash, letting my cast iron pan soak, and eating right.
And I'm Roxy Polk, and I was just thinking about the existential dread of human existence because I just played the video game Soma.
Soma.
Mikey, have you played this game?
I have played that game. You know what, Roxy? Since we're down here in the scary basement, what do you say we do what we do when we're down here and recap Soma?
Let's do it.
I'm going to be honest with you, Roxy. I think I'm going to be able to keep most of my body because
okay.
I did get to a point in this video game where I was like, I don't like this gameplay anymore.
And really?
I just watched the YouTube video.
Oh my god.
And I liked
that. That makes me so sad.
So much more.
Okay.
So enamored to be watching this game instead of playing this game.
Okay.
But
that's fair. As long as you enjoyed it, that's goal for me.
All right. What do you say we get into the plot recap?
All right, let's do it.
We begin the game playing as Simon Jarrett, your average everyday guy who has a head injury. After a car accident that killed his friend, who is maybe his girlfriend, Simon goes to see a doctor, David Munchie, to help fix his brain bleed. Munchie sits Simon down for a brain scan, and Simon blacks out. And it's then that he wakes up in the robot future.
Yeah, I guess I should say that this takes place, what, in Canada in, like, 2015? Like, basically, like, the year the game came out. So it's supposed to be, like, modern-day just Canada when you're walking around.
Yes.
And it has that really cool, like, twist to it where, yeah, you wake up in that chair and suddenly you're like, wait, what?
Yeah, they do a pretty good job of, like, setting up. You're just a normal dude. You have a job at, like, a bookstore and you have, like, a phone call with your boss that I really enjoyed.
Yeah.
It's good. It's a, like, good setup.
Yeah.
And I do feel like I've lost something when all of a sudden I'm like, oh, surprise. You blinked in. You're like, sit down in this chair and blink. He's like, oh, just take a second. And then you wake up in the future.
Yeah, in this place that is very strange and doesn't look anything like any of the technology or structures you're used to seeing.
Yeah.
Still looks human-made, but also in very bad shape.
I described it as looking like some sort of space station that's sort of decaying.
Yeah, that's the thing, too. Like, you have no idea. You could be in space.
Could be anything.
You don't know.
Roxy, think back to the first time you played this game. What did you think was going on?
I think in that, I avoided a lot of trailers, so I didn't necessarily know the location of where I was at. So I think until they revealed that, I did think that maybe we were in space or something.
I was so certain we were in my man's mind.
Oh, okay.
And we were going to go through and fight monsters and everything, but it would be like fighting the parts of your bleeding brain. Like, that's how you would fix your brain. I was so sure.
Oh, okay.
Is that what's happening? Stay tuned. Simon wanders around this space station, dodging scary goo monsters and also putting his hand inside some goo friends.
Friends, huh? Interesting way to phrase that. They look like these weird cyber demon butthole things. It's just like, what is that?
Roxy, if you walked up to me and put your entire arm down my throat, I would not consider you a stranger.
I guess that's true. That's a good point.
Like, oh yeah, we're close now.
So is that, we're saying that's the WoW's throat then? Is that what it was for you?
I mean, that's the PG version of what it's We soon learn that Simon is in an underwater facility, not in space. It's owned by the company Pathos 2. Simon meets a number of robots who believe that they are human beings. Now, this is a big moment for me. Carl is his name, right?
Yes, Carl. Okay. I was like, we gotta talk about Carl.
You're in this game, you're running around, you're solving puzzles, you're like flipping switches and opening doors. There's a little bit of like monsters chasing you. And then
you honestly have no idea what's going on.
Right.
Nobody you can talk to. Nothing makes any sense. You're just like, I guess I'll open this door and go here.
Right. So you find this robot named Carl. And God bless him, he thinks he's a person, but you're like, no, you look like, he looks like a 1950s kind of science fiction-y robot.
Yeah, like boxy robot. I think he's got like clamp hands even. Doesn't even have like eyes. Like maybe he has some digital optics kind of, I think, but basically it.
You go and you find a switch that's going to unlock the door you need to get through or whatever. And you flip it, and it fucking electrocutes our guy, Carl!
Yeah, and he's, like, screaming in pain and, like, asking for help and asking you to stop.
It's really bad. It's, like, really troubling. And I'm just like, okay, I immediately ran back and turned the switch off.
Yes. Yeah, yeah. Me too.
And you cannot progress in this game if you don't throw the switch on and leave it on.
Yeah.
To get
and, like,
the way
Carl, too, keeps insisting, because, like, if you keep talking to him, you have the ability to be, like, no, like, you look like a robot, and he keeps insisting it so much that eventually your character is just like, okay.
All right, dude.
Sure. All right.
Yeah, it's very, a man who would hassle you at 7-Eleven energy.
Yeah, like, he even has, like, an accent, too. Like, is it a Boston accent or something?
Oh, it might be.
But, like, after you flip that switch, too, you go through that doorway, and then you're greeted with Carl's actual corpse that has, like, his ID card, and it's like, what is happening?
So we got two Carls, one digital, one human. That's upsetting. At that point, Simon, our player character, gets a radio call from a woman named Catherine, and he puts on an underwater suit and walks at the seafloor to go find her.
Well, I think, isn't that when you're chased by a monster and you unlock, or, like, you lock yourself away from the creature, but then trying to escape, it basically, like, caves in the ceiling, and you're in a dive suit?
Could be.
Sorry. It happens, like, a couple of times, so I can't remember if that's the first time or the second time.
Digitally, like, looks at his hands and, like, a space suit, forms on him or something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because, like, this whole time you've been seeing it, whenever you see your hands, you're seeing, like, your flesh human hands not in a suit or anything.
Yeah, he just, like, grows an underwater suit, which is cool.
Yeah, essentially. Yeah.
So, Simon goes on a little quest to find Catherine. When he does find her, oh no, she's a robot too.
She's chill.
Catherine's mind has been uploaded, scanned, and placed inside something other than her birth body, which we find out is also what happened to Simon. This is what happened to Simon when his brain was scanned. They took his memories, his personality, and they uploaded it, and now his body, or his brain has been transferred to another body. So we're like, okay, great. This is what's going on.
I think, like, Catherine even refers to him as being, like, a legacy scan or something. His brain was, like, the prototype. He's, like, the Unity tool or something that, like, comes with the brain scan kit to teach you, like, how you do this.
Uh-huh. Our very own, like, Adam.
Yeah, so who knows how many times he's been, like, uploaded and messed with and deleted and whatever.
Oh, at least four.
Yeah, I mean, like, also, you don't know how much time has passed, I don't think. Maybe there's a date. I think there might be. But just, like, a lot more time has passed than Simon thought.
Yes, he basically went in the year 2015 and woke up later.
Yeah, I think it was, like, 2020?
I think we eventually find out it's, like, 2104.
Yeah, yeah. Like, I was gonna say, I knew it was, like, at least 100 years, I think, or so.
So, Catherine's consciousness is now in a little handheld computer chip, while Simon's consciousness is in the body of a dead woman. That's cool. That's a cool reveal when you find out that there's another
employee. Like, skipping ahead. Well, yeah, that's, like,
And this is kind of why I got into, like, watching this on YouTube as opposed to playing it. There's a lot of, like, go over here, unlock the door. You need to find the security code. And it's like, all right, what's going on? I think these
definitely stop me if I'm
missing something cool.
I'd say something important would be the guy who's, like, being corrupted by the WoW and talking about how you see more of the WoW, like, taking over the station, taking over robots, taking over dead bodies and, like, keeping them alive through, like, weird false organs. Like, there's this one lady you encounter who is gasping for breath and is like, please, it won't let me die. And it's got, like, an artificial lung stuck to this wall that's connected to her body.
And so the WoW is, like, this goop that's kind of... This is the goo stuff that is kind of, like, corrupting this station.
It looks like mecha organic, kind of. Like, it doesn't look completely organic because it's got, like, these blue lights in it.
Mm-hmm.
But it is, like, this weird black goopy kind of, like, oil substance as well.
Yeah, and it's, like, it's powering the monsters, right?
Yes, it's definitely keeping them alive or, like, corrupting them or something. Like, each of them kind of have different... What would be the description for it? like ways they've been distorted, I guess.
Hmm.
Like no monster is distorted the same way.
Right. So we've got the WoW's in play. The WoW. Yes. Do we know what the WoW is at this point?
Yes. The WoW is the computer that is supposed to be keeping the station together, because there's multiple different station like hubs. Mm-hmm. So it's like overall one giant station, but there's each, I think there's like beta, gamma, theta, sigma, like different structures that do different things, mm-hmm. To keep their whole superstructure going, I guess. And so they needed a computer to kind of control all of that. And also, like, regulate, you know, keeping them alive underwater with everything else. But so I think one of the technicians, maybe it's the technician who was looking over it. His name is escaping me right now, but he gets a little too in deep with it and becomes obsessed with experimenting with the WoW's, like, goop.
Yeah.
Putting it into humans, putting it into other things.
What happens when we start throwing artificial intelligence into our bones?
Yeah, and he starts doing it to himself as well. It's a very kind of Birkin moment.
I like it a lot. Yeah, the WoW is cool. I never really got it, I feel like. But okay. I liked the element of it, that there's just this artificial intelligence that's kind of gone rogue, and it's also kind of soupy.
And yeah, they like everywhere. They describe it like a cancer. It doesn't have free-thinking thought the way that, like, you know, a sentient being would, but it has a objective, essentially, which is like to keep things on the station alive and running. And then when things go bad and people are dying and
yeah,
shit, that gets distorted.
And so it's like bringing people back from the dead, right?
Yeah. So like keeping people alive, even if it's like a horrifying body horror situation that they didn't ask for.
Oof, I love it. So we find out.
No good.
We find out that OG Simon has been dead for at least 100 years. The Munchie treatment didn't work. We find a heartbreaking journal entry where Dr. Munchie tells the original Simon, like, I'm sorry. I tried to help you. I couldn't get it done. Broke my heart, Roxy.
Yeah, it was very well acted, and it's very sad, especially because it's like a voice recording. So you hear, like, Munchie and Simon. And Simon essentially, like, kind of makes his peace with it. And he's like, well, thanks for doing all that you can. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if my brain scan can help people in the future, you know, that's enough for me.
So, and that's what starts to get into, like, the interesting part of this story. It's like, you've been having an experience as this person just going forward, and you find out at some point what actually was you, what originally was you, died, and now you're just picking it up?
Yeah, like, you're just the copy. You're a copy of the original.
Mm-hmm.
And not only that, you're inhabiting the body of, like, a dead woman who, she's been decapitated, essentially, because they needed to put the mechanical parts, which is some optics and the WoW's structure gel, is holding it all together. And, like, the only reason why it works is because when Simon looks down at his hands, there is a human body there, even if it's not his. So it's kind of like his perception makes him not go insane.
Right.
The way many other robots on the station have, including the monsters who come after you.
And the robots do in real life.
Yeah, in real life right now. Like the, what is that dog robot that can run very fast and open doors?
Yeah, no, he's based off Astro from the Jetsons.
Is he really?
No, I don't know. I just said a thing. I couldn't think of the name of the actual thing. I know you're talking about. He does little flips.
Yeah, yeah.
Very cute. So at this point, we find out that down in these sea labs, the scientists of Pathos 2 are in fact the last human beings alive after a comet struck the planet and killed everyone on the surface. So we got Catherine, who has a plan to save humanity. We're going to take a satellite.
She kind of figured out a way to, or she invented the way to do this using the brain scans that Simon is. Basically doing that with the crew.
The idea is to shoot a solar-powered satellite into space with the brain scans of everybody from Pathos 2, the best of the best.
Definitely not insane, last people left after.
Yeah, the craziest people who have kind of turned into monsters.
Yeah.
And so she also builds them this, like, matrix-like alternate reality that is, she describes as this, like, beautiful place where all of the brain scans can go live for eternity. And it sounds nice, but also, to me, I don't know how you felt about it, kind of haunting.
Yeah, I mean, like, it kind of gets to part of the ending that happens in the game, too, but, like, as you're progressing through the various locations to, like, get this objective completed, You run into other people who have, like, signed up for it, and a bunch of them did a weird, like, suicide pact thing. They didn't tell the captain. Catherine Chun had no idea they were going to do it, mm-hmm. where, like, after they take their brain scan, they kill themselves because then there's only one authentic them that is in the system, and they're not still trapped in their human body. And I think it's like they think, I don't know, whether it's because they only want to have one of them or they are thinking it's transferring instead of copying. I'm not sure.
Well, everybody's also like very obsessed with like the purity of the self. They're like, I am the true self, but am I the true self? I'm the scan. And so like that's what the suicide pact is about. They're like, well, I'm going to make the true self the me on the arc.
Yeah.
And I don't know. I did not agree with that. I was like, we can all be our true selves. The true self, they're all the true selves. They're all just people.
I do want to ask what you did. There's a woman who, she's just in a complete robot body that is kind of like damaged and just sitting underwater.
Mm-hmm.
And she thinks she's in the Ark because she had the brain scan. And for whatever reason, her mind is also in this robot.
Mm.
And so she's talking about how like, oh, you know, it looks different than I thought it would. Yeah, where are all the others? Like, I'm just kind of on my own. I'm a little confused about that. But, hey, Catherine really did it. And you can just leave her down there by herself, thinking she is in the Ark. Mm-hmm. Or you can end her and unplug her.
Well, I'm surprised.
What did you do?
I'm surprised it hasn't come up yet. This game is obsessed with giving you the option to euthanize people. I don't know that is it possible to skip her or?
Oh yeah, you don't have to kill her. She's optional. Like Carl and the little robot.
I don't know that I found her.
Oh really? Okay. She's like in front of a door talking. I guess you can like choose to not talk to her maybe.
This also could have come when I had switched to YouTube. And,
maybe that. And that's unfortunate then.
Yeah.
It's a really neat little interaction. There's also that part with I think I saw you playing part of this on Twitch. With a little, like, helper robot who is, like, opening doors for you.
Yeah.
And then you need, like, a power cell. The little robot has it, but there's also some, like, weird deranged but conscious robots down there who also have it. So you can essentially choose to, like, oh, I need to progress so I can either kill this little helper robot, well, kill, quote-unquote, however you want to interpret it, or end these other guys over here who have been like vaguely hostile but not like outright attacking you, and also like they don't understand where they are and they're kind of just like in this loop repeating what they're saying, not because they're NPCs but just because they are like fucked
stuck
up,
stuck in a loop. Yeah.
Yes, exactly. They're stuck in a loop. Yeah. So I think, did you choose to go after one of the like rambling guys or did you go for the little guy?
I went for the little guy.
Okay.
And I don't remember why. That was actually, I think, the last part of the game that I played.
Because
it was so hard to, like, pick up the stun rod and just, like, aim your little mouse cursor with a controller. Like, I was like, I was here. I was in this location before. And it just didn't give me the option to pick it up because I wasn't half a degree over. And I was like, I'm going to enjoy this story way more if I sit back and let it happen instead of, like, clumsily trying to force it.
Yeah, there's some parts that are just really expansive, mostly the underwater parts. Kind of like when you're in the facility, it's a little more clear where you're supposed to go. But when you're underwater, you're just like walking on the ocean floor with these huge expansive environments. And with the exception of like a part later where you're just following lights in like a straight line, essentially, and avoiding danger, that part that you were talking about, you're just like let loose on this huge area and have to figure out what to do. There's a lot of like cool atmospheric like notes or like memories from dead bodies that you can interact with and stuff, but at the same time, if you're looking for just how to get to the next objective, it can be a little obtuse in that part.
Yeah, it was tough.
Okay,
so Catherine's plan is to save humanity by putting some brains on a satellite, but something goes wrong. The Ark never launched, and that goo freaks start getting created. They're goo freaks, Roxy.
Yeah, he started killing people, like, injecting so much structure gel into people that they would just, like, die. And I think he himself did that to himself. And then he, like, got back up and his body disappeared. And they're like, what?
Love that.
Yeah.
So at this point, we are following Simon and Catherine as they explore the station. They solve puzzles. They hide from monsters. They wrestle of the question of what it means to be alive. As they find themselves in a lot of people where they have someone, a lot of situations rather, where they have to euthanize someone. It keeps coming up and I liked it every time. I was like, we're doing this again.
Are you going to touch on the part where, like, you have to trick some of the other brain scans?
Ooh, no.
I'm not sure if because that's around that same area.
I did watch that.
Yeah, so there's this part in the simulation where you need, or, well, not in the simulation, but you need information from a character who is deceased. But he has a brain scan that you can stick into, like, the machine and ask him questions. But because it is basically an entire human mind, he's a little more perceptive to be like, wait, this place is weird. It doesn't make any sense. Wait, what are you doing? What are you talking about? Where the fuck am I? So, like, you have to come up with a location and a voice to emulate and information and, like, a way of talking to convince him to give you this code.
Right. It's very funny. You have to, like, set him on the beach or something. You can, like, put him, make him think he's on the beach.
Yeah, and, like, he gets freaked out by it because he was like, wait, I was just in this chair getting my brain scan. Like, why am I on the beach? And so, like, you have to emulate, like, his dead girlfriend's voice. But, like, Catherine is very... One of the interesting things is Catherine's characterization in this game. I really liked it, how she's kind of disaffected, but at the same time feels more at home in, like, a robot body and, like, free of her human body than, like, any of the other characters. It's probably one of the reasons why she's still sane, with, like, everything else.
Can I tell you?
Yeah, yeah.
Catherine, every single time, Simon was like, this is immoral. We can't do it. And Catherine's like, nah, it's fine. I was like, dude, Catherine gets it.
Yeah.
I couldn't agree with Catherine anymore in every turn. Because she's just like, no, they're just fucking robots. And he's like, oh, but they're thinking and processing. It's like, so fucking what, dude? Yeah, they all killed themselves and they all died. And then you bring them back and who cares?
Yeah. Like,
we're marbles in a bag, Roxy. Nothing matters. The universe is chaos. What is meaning? What is self? The answer is nothing. It's a babbling brook. It's spitting out too many popcorn shrimp that you put in your mouth. It's gibberish. Nothing matters. And we should kill all the robots and bring them all back and nothing will change.
Well, that's one way of looking at it. I think it's interesting, though, that you're bringing up the dynamic between Catherine and Simon throughout the whole game, because they're kind of just like talking about the nature of existence and, like, the self and the human mind, especially because, you know, Simon is somebody from our time period, you know, from our viewpoint. He is our viewpoint character. Having to wrestle with, like, this insane situation and also realizing that he himself is not human anymore, like, in the traditional sense. So then it is kind of like, yeah, are you just, like, your mind? Like, can you exist in a different body like this and feel the same?
Yeah, I can. So, and I do.
Yeah.
I exist in my mind and my body, and sometimes I lose one and then sometimes the other. And again, don't give a shit. Whatever happens to my body or mind, fine. It's all happenstance. So along the way, we learn about the goo, which you already talked about. It's called the Warden Unit. I wonder if that's why the word warden was stuck in my head.
That's gotta be. Yeah. I didn't even think about that.
The WAU, but it's gone nuts. It's putting people into everything. This is my favorite moment when you, like, there's like a submarine you can escape from and you find out that the submarine is sentient. And it's like, what's going on? I'm a submarine. And then the submarine just, like, escapes.
No, I think isn't it the WoW technician guy trying to stop you and guide you towards the WoW? Because he's got, throughout the game, you've been seeing visions and shadows of this guy kind of, like, saying these weird cryptic things to you. And you're like, I don't know what the fuck you mean. Am I going insane? Who knows?
Mm-hmm. This game's really good at like, leveling up its mystery. It's like, once you learn exactly what's going on and exactly where Simon is, then you're like, okay, well, what is this goo? And then once you kind of figure out what the goo is, you're like, okay, who's this man? And what happened to the Ark? And, like, it's really good at, like, doling out its secrets.
Yes, it's pacing. I absolutely love it. Like, I've played this game multiple times and watched it played multiple times, and I feel myself going back to it quite a lot, just watching other people's playthroughs and stuff, because they do such a good job at the pacing, as you said. It's very good storytelling.
Mm-hmm. Now, with their only vehicle that can get them to the Ark alive and scared, what the hell did I just write?
Because they're going deeper and deeper.
There's just one vehicle
down
that can...
into the water, too. So they're going to get, like, combusted.
Yes. Yeah. Simon and Catherine have to go to the deepest ocean, and to do that without getting crushed, they have to transfer Simon's consciousness into another, more pressure-sensitive robot body. Here we learn how the brain switching works. It is not transferring, it is copying. So, when Simon sits down to put his brain into a higher, a better diving suit body, he wakes up and he's in the body, as one would expect. But then he hears another Simon in the room that sat down to transfer his body. So where there was one, now there is two. This is the problem that the Suicide Pact was trying to avoid. All of a sudden, who is the true Simon? And the only one you can choose is yourself, because that's the one you're playing as.
Yeah, and like, I think the body in that one, or like that one was powering down as well, right? Or at the very least, like it can't go anywhere. Like, I think you've got a monster on one side of the door and then the abyss on the other.
Ooh.
So you're just faced with this idea of like, are you gonna let yourself sit here in like nothing and like go insane or just exist in this room?
Yeah.
And also, I think that's when you learn that Simon is inhabiting a corpse, essentially.
Oh, that, is that like, when the corpse detail comes up?
Yeah. And so, like, you also have to try and find another body, another headless body that you can use for that, which is very, like, it's quite twisted, because you have to find that, and then, like, the little, God, the head is, it just looks like some computer chips with some eye goggles on it, and then, like, a neck stick cord thing to just jam it into the corpse.
It's pretty good.
Then you use the structure gel. It's quite horrifying.
And this, again,
extremely interesting.
As the game wants you to do, it makes you choose whether or not you can euthanize yourself. Roxy, which one did you choose?
I couldn't let him sit there. I was like,
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, I did. And I didn't feel great about it, but I felt better than leaving him there.
See,
I
definitely left him there.
Oh, shit. It's like a nightmare, though.
Well, because it's like, I don't know, maybe he'll find meaning there in a small room. Maybe he'll kill himself and take that choice on his own, and I wouldn't fault him for it. But he can figure that out. He'll do it himself. Everything is nothing. The world is chaos.
It's very interesting to learn this about you, about like, that's one of the things I like about this game, too. It does kind of make you make these choices that are essentially optional. Like, yeah, you can just walk away, or you can kill him.
Which
or
is also the funniest option.
You can think about the implications of both of it. And also, like, this whole time, Catherine has been essentially, like, telling Simon that it's a copy. You're a copy. It's not a transfer. And, like, he doesn't get it until then, and he, like, gets mad at her. And she's like, I don't know how many times I can keep telling you.
It's very funny.
Like, it's and so it's like, you can understand his, like, rage and sadness at it, because he hasn't processed it. But at the same time, it's like, you have no choice but to confront it.
Sure. It's very, like, it's frightening in a way that, like, it wasn't a harder choice for me. I felt like every time they were presenting these big options to me, I was like, well, it's obvious. You just do this and let him make the choice. But Simon, the character that I am playing as and ostensibly empathizing with, is like, are you insane? You're a monster. Do you care about people at all? And I was like, uh-oh, do I?
Ooh. Yeah. I mean, there's two sides to that, too, because being more pragmatic about it, or like more of like a realistic take on it, or like trying to be hopeful, like you were talking about, how it's like, oh, maybe he would find meaning somehow if he was given a chance.
I think I would be really good if I got stuck in a room for forever about figuring out a way to find meaning.
In that little tiny room with something that wants to kill you on the other side and the abyss on the other.
I'd write
poetry. With nobody with you except for a corpse.
I would write some beautiful poetry, and I would...
Where are you going to write it on?
In my brain.
Okay.
And then I would be like, once I really like something, then I'll just repeat it over and over, and it'll get seared in my brain. And I don't know, maybe I'll figure out a way to scratch into the metal.
And then the aliens will show up and find the last dregs of humanity, and you're just sitting in a corner repeating the same lines to a poem, rocking back and forth.
The words I love you are the words that can be spoken to a love most true. Yeah. So Simon leaves his former body on the ocean floor.
Got an upgrade.
They euthanize him, and then they head out to the deep ocean. Or not, that's true. In the deep ocean, Simon and Catherine meet Sarah, the last human alive. I love Sarah. She's still kicking.
She's great, yeah.
She's on a life support system that the WoW is powering, maybe? Or is she separate from the WoW?
No, she's not.
WoW?
she very smartly, like, partitions herself away from the WoW. Mm. It's kind of the whole thing is why she doesn't trust you initially, because she's like, everything's insane down here. Why would I trust what you're saying to me?
Yeah.
So she's kind of, like, locked in this room. I think she's on an IV drip, though. She's, like, super skinny. You know, she can't even really move. She can barely even, like, talk to you and look at you by that point.
But she is the last...
And I think she's, like, in her 20s also. And she looks nothing like it. Like, it's very... interesting and heartbreaking. Yeah.
I would have guessed she was like 45.
Right?
Minimum. So, like a sickly 45.
Yeah.
But she is the last remaining human that is purely human.
Yeah. She's the entire planet.
But it's like, wow, she's on a life support system. So it's like, what does it mean to be alive, you know? Wow. A lot of big questions.
Well, she essentially decided she was going to guard the Ark because she, they had a fight, her and the other people who were taking it to get launched. They were like, well, was it like the slingshot or like the rocket thing?
Yes.
They were like, it could have been damaged. We could just send it out there and it'll explode. And then there's no humanity anywhere. So we're going to keep it here and not launch it yet.
Mm-hmm.
And so like everybody disagreed about it. And so essentially it never got launched for that reason. So she's just been holding on to it in the hopes that something can be done. Well, she can't move and she's just like, we need to do something with it, but I don't know what to do with it. So that's why essentially she leaves it up to you.
Mm-hmm. You of course get the choice to euthanize her.
Yeah. Well, she also asks you to.
Yeah. Oh, her I killed.
Yeah.
I mean, I wasn't playing. I was watching it on YouTube for sure by this point, but I was like, "Oh, I would have killed her."
Yeah.
Without question. She asked for it. I don't know. Who am I?
And like Her last words, I can't remember them exactly, but I just remember, like, there's this sort of somber acceptance to, like, she is the last human alive, and she's gone, and, like, you're there for it.
How tight would it be to kill the last human?
Oh, that would be extremely depressing. I did it in the game.
Then you're officially the best human. You're the champion. But then,
I mean, if you still exist as a human, yeah.
Yeah.
That's how that works.
Every pro wrestling championship, every Olympic gold medal, every Nobel Peace Prize, that belongs to you now.
No one else is there to take it.
Exactly. So Sarah's gone. At this point, our heroes are, I wrote heroes in quotes, like,
yeah.
Who am I trying to impress here?
Our protagonists.
Our protagonists are attacked by John Ross, another Pathos 2 scientist. This is the man who's been creepily popping into our perception. He has begun to merge with the WoW. He gives Simon the chance to euthanize the WoW. It's very funny. Yep. He's like, explain this a little more, because I missed some of these details, but Simon has the power to destroy the WoW.
Yeah, like something about his blood and the way he is right now allows it. So every single time you've been putting your hand into those like weird fleshy WoW holes.
Mouth pots, they call them.
Yes, mouth pots?
Pots. So pots of mouth.
Pots. Okay, you did say pots. It refreshes your health. So like if you were hit by zombies or like other creatures, it will hurt you. But if you do that, it will reinvigorate you, essentially gives you health back. There isn't like a health bar or something. It's just kind of vague about it.
Very confusing. I had no idea if I was... safe. I didn't know how to make my screen stop shaking. It was upsetting.
Yeah, well, that's kind of part of it, too. It's what I like is that you sort of figure it out organically, although maybe your experience will vary.
It was a little much for me.
But so, yeah, essentially, you can destroy the WoW, and he's, like, brought you here to do that.
And also, this is a thing that I missed. Was this... So, the video I watched, and I would have done it, I euthanized the WoW.
I definitely did too, because the way it is, it's just like misshaping things. Yeah. Like what is keeping alive? They're not being kept alive. That's not life to me. You're not just your biological.
The point of being alive is making choices. And when the WoW comes in and starts making choices that I know my friends like Sarah and Carl would not approve of, well, I got to get rid of you. I'm sorry. At that point, is John Ross eaten by the submarine? Is that what happens?
I'm trying to find, like, the exact play-by-play. So let's see.
Something deus ex machina, like, John Ross, like, you kill the WoW, and then he turns to you and he's like, well, I can't leave you out there, because he, like, risks the WoW coming back somehow.
So, Ross recovered from the Abyss Climber rig, placed his body inside a containment cell. Through the manipulation of electromagnetic fields, the WoW remotely directed structure gel inside of Ross to repair his body, and that energy, like, put a strain on the equipment and everything. Black boxes inside all the human staff, yeah. Mm. So that gave a bunch of them headaches. Let's see. Okay, so the WoW, like, kind of basically went insane and overloaded all the staff and the systems. I think you have the structure gel that you put into your new body.
Mm-hmm.
When you transfer, that is essentially, like, the virus to the WoW.
Because,
mm. like, you see images of the guy who is directing you there.
Got it.
So he, like, specifically has you use that structure gel. But in doing so, like, you would have to kind of die, I think, essentially. Because mm-hmm. it needs to absorb the poison.
Right. So that happens. that all yeah. stuff happens. John Ross, he's crazy, you know? He's like, now, thank you for doing the thing I asked. Now I have to kill you. And then he gets killed somehow.
Yeah.
something explodes. I like to think it was the submarine. The submarine that freaked out before, came back, and was just like, wow, I'm still a submarine! Well, and just plows
through
him.
Well, he's like
him.
Down there. Like, you lose your arm. So if you choose to kill the WoW, you insert your arm in. And then your arm is just gone for the whole rest of the game.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, because the WoW is essentially folding in on itself and dying. When that guy is trying to kill you, he actually gets killed by the WoW, like, crushing mm. him. And you just, like, barely make it out.
Uh-huh. So, after this whole encounter, Simon and Catherine reach the Ark. They get there. They found it. There they, of course, find Catherine's body. Catherine,
sadly.
Human body Catherine, killed by her co-workers over a weird scuffle. One of those weird, like, Catherine, you're not getting through this door. And she's like, but I'm going through the door. And then they're like, and then they're like, oh, God, what happened?
It was, like, the argument. So, like, she wanted to send out the Ark no matter what. And then her supervisor was like, oh, but it could get damaged, and then there's no Ark at all. Mm-hmm. And she's like, we've only got one shot. We have to do it. Otherwise, it's just going to rot down here.
Yeah.
And so they kind of, like, have a shoving match. He accidentally shoves her, and she hits her head and dies while she's trying to get control over the Ark to send it up.
Unbelievable. Catherine.
And they just leave her where they killed her also. Like, you just find her there. And, like, the whole deal is, too, is that, as we said, Catherine seems to feel more at home in a synthetic body, mm-hmm. Like, outside of her human body, but, like, she still never knew what happened to her human self. So she kind of, like, theorizes what could have happened, and there's an interesting kind of, like, somberness when she does finally have that realization.
Yeah. It was my friends all along.
I guess that, yeah.
Once they reach the Ark, Simon learns that he's going to have to again copy himself to get onto the Ark. He does so, and there's this really tense sequence that I love
it's
where it's
very
like,
good.
It downloads Catherine's personality onto the Ark, and they're like, great. And then Simon's personality, it's like, 10, 9, and it's like stuck. It's like the most unsettling, like, copying a file on your computer progress bar that I've ever seen.
Because, like, everything's, like, falling apart, and they've only got one shot, and if he doesn't download himself in time for the Ark to shoot out, then that's just it.
He's
not going to be on it. Yeah.
And the last minute, the progress bar fills up. Simon made it onto the Ark. He's like, woo!
He's so excited, yeah. He's like, yeah,
living!
I did it!
And he closes his eyes and he wakes up and he's still sitting in that same fucking chair. And he's like, hey, what happened? I thought I was going to get on the Ark. And Catherine's like, you did.
Well, they also use up, like, the last of the power as well. So the power to the station is powering down. And so you're Simon in that chair having done the upload with Catherine there. And he's like, wait, why am I not on it?
He doesn't get it.
And Catherine's like, we've done this before. Like, you know, like, you're not, it's the coin toss. They come up with this thing of this, like, theory or concept of the coin toss. Because, mm-hmm. like, your consciousness is still going to be in this other place where you copied it. But, like, you're still here.
There's still the other person who has a 50% chance of being the one left behind.
Yeah, whichever, like, your perception is. So it's kind of like, yeah, just 50-50 and you're going to. You lost the coin toss.
Mm-hmm.
So the last thing that the Simon that you've been playing as experiences, essentially, is just, like, this fight with Catherine. Power goes out, her thing isn't active anymore, and then you're just, like, left by yourself in the darkness in the crumbling station.
Mm-hmm. But hopeful.
I mean, that's, like, one version of Simon. So
it's,
then
it's again, that's the, like, idea that Catherine, in, like, her final moments as she's powering down, she's just like, be happy, you did it. You did get on there. And I was like, again.
Yeah, and you did, like, a good thing. You sent everybody else out there, too.
Yeah, Catherine's right. I'm just like, yeah. I am happy for other me. It sucks it's not me, but I'm glad it's somebody.
But it's, like, hard not to feel bad for Simon, too, because, like, you still don't want to be stuck down there. Even if you could be happy for that other self, you are still there.
I think you're I would just write a lot of really great poetry.
Yeah, in the darkness of the bottom of the ocean, as, you know, big metal structures are probably falling on you. But sorry, I wanted to make sure we got through how depressing that was before.
No. It sucks. It's a really interesting and cool ending that, like, it almost felt to me like the story had been promising the whole time. It's like, wow, yeah. Lucky again. You're the one who gets to go do the fun adventures. It's like, until the last one.
Yeah.
Which is a bummer.
And it's just kind of like, that's exactly what happened to the Simon in the chair. He thought he was going to be the one going.
Mm.
And you're a copy, but it's the consciousness hasn't been interrupted for you.
Right.
So, like, you don't, because you don't have perception of it when mm-hmm. it's done in that way.
And so there's a post-credit scene, too, right?
Yeah. Yeah. So, like, I think the credit scene is where you see the arc go out. So it is in space. And, mm-hmm. like, you get this really cool view of, like, the planet being destroyed and kind of, like, the arc going on its journey, being smaller and smaller and smaller mm-hmm. until you can't see it anymore. So.
And then you see the other Simon's point of view for yeah. a second. You yes, play yeah. as so the like, other Simon, right? And so you yeah. are in the arc and you get to see what this beautiful world looks like. And it's pretty nice. It's like a lush, you like open up in a cave and then you come out yeah. into like a jungle. And it's the only like lush natural location we've seen the entire game.
Yeah, there's like natural light. There's like the sounds of birds. There's like a babbling brook. You can hear like trees swaying. Like they did a very good job mm-hmm. to like have these different juxtapositions and locations. And then and also like Simon's in like his button up shirt. He's got his human arms.
Right. He looks like himself as he remembers himself. And he wanders through this location and he finds human Catherine.
Yeah. And she's like I think she's like waving at him too. So it's like yeah. the first time you actually get to see her.
And that's Soma.
That's Soma.
I will say, what did you think about that post-credit scene?
I liked it, because I liked that we got to see something about in the arc, because I was very interested in it. And because there is two sides to that. Like, there is that existential, like, despair, but also there is that flip side of hope of, you know, they can at least live in a virtual world, and maybe there will be a civilization or something will find them. Who knows when, if ever. At least we've got a shot. More of a shot than living down in the in the ocean. So it was cool to be able to like see what that looked like, even if it's just very briefly, like essentially the lobby of this world.
I wish there was a way for them to have done it differently. Like it felt like we were always in the perception of this Simon, and then it felt like a cheat to jump to the other one who like won. Like they were telling one story about like, damn, wouldn't it suck to be the bad clone? Basically.
Yeah, yeah.
And it felt a little cheap. I wish that our Simon could have found, because I think you're right, you need to get into that arc. To not see the yeah. arc would have been disappointing. But I wish yeah. there was a way that, like, Simon could have, like, right as it launched, they're like, and this is what it is. And they, like, be happy for the people who left. And then it powers down. And then he, like, loses it. I wish there was a way to have kept it perspective wise always on him, and that just is maybe my like rule brain that's just like, ooh, you promised me it would only be from his perspective, because then at that point why aren't we jumping into the other Simon halfway through, why aren't we jumping into,
but like we kind of did, like from the beginning, you know, like we play as human flesh and blood Simon, then we're playing as brain scan Simon, then we're playing a second brain scan Simon.
But that's what I mean, like we were getting this one line and then we were shown two lines for the last scene.
So basically you just didn't want any interruption. You wanted to immediately yeah. wake up in that chair. Okay.
Yes. I wanted to wake up. Like,
I liked being stuck in the darkness in that final scene and seeing what happens to him, especially because like he can't, you know, power down his self, his second oh, yeah. self.
I wish that was the end.
Oh, really? Okay. Yeah. Just like we didn't see it then. Okay. Right.
I wish we didn't see the arc at the end. I wish we had found a way to like explore the arc, and then now it's time to get out and put your body in it or whatever, and then he doesn't get it.
It felt like so much more visceral, I guess, like seeing his reaction, especially like with Catherine being like, you knew this was it, like just be mm-hmm. happy for them.
Yeah,
because like it is such a natural reaction, because as much as I would be happy for my other self, I'd still be fucking angry and upset that I'm still stuck here dying.
Wow. Like really selfish, Roxy.
Yeah, I mean, I can feel two things at once.
Should we talk about the big question of this movie game?
We should. I mean, I feel like we've kind of done it. Yeah, we accidentally have. And also, especially right here. But yeah, let's talk about it.
I have a thesis statement for this game. Okay. And I know you said it's kind of about a lot of things. So do you want to hear my thesis statement first, or do you want to throw out six or seven of the things that you thought it was about?
I would love to hear your thesis statement on it. Hit me.
I think the big idea is, what does it mean to be alive? And then it's just iterations on that. If there are two of you, are you still alive? If you're on life support, are you still alive? If you're underwater, are you still alive? If you're isolated, are you still alive? And I liked that idea a lot because it did make me think, like, oh, what's important to me? What do I think it means to be alive? And that's kind of like, I think this game is really kind of magic in the sense that it makes you answer that. And you get to decide, does life support, does being the last member of humanity mean that you're alive? Is humanity alive if its last living person is on life support? And it's like, oh, well, to me, that does not constitute being alive because you can't hit certain criteria. And it like forced me to write down in words for maybe the first time in my life what I think it means to be alive.
Okay.
The things I wrote is, I think it's important to speak, listen, and be heard.
Okay.
Because once you are unable to like express yourself, be it through art or music or poetry, that's you like, okay, now I'm alive. I am making something. I am in the world. I am doing something. I am speaking. It's to listen, which is like kind of the joy of exploration and travel and like taking in the world. What does the world have to say to you? And to be heard is about like community. You need somebody to listen to what you're saying too, because otherwise you're just talking into a vacuum and who gives a shit. And so that's why I was like, okay, so other Simon, he can still speak. He can still listen. He just can't be heard. And that sucks. And that's a brutal thing, but he's still hitting 2 or 3. So I was like, okay, therefore to me, he is still alive and I'm going to leave him still alive. Sarah had, first of all, choice circumvents everything. She decided she didn't want to, but she had no one to, no way to communicate with the world, no way to project herself, no way to put herself out there. She had nothing to listen to. She had no inputs. She was stuck in one room. And there was nobody around besides Simon, who shows up and is about to leave again. There's nobody for her to, like, tell her stories to. So there's just, like, there's nothing. So it's like, of course I would kill her.
Yeah, I think especially because, like, she asks you of her own free will for this request. And it's like, I'm the only one who can do this for her. And I think, yeah, based on, you're talking a lot about, like, situational and kind of, like, sensory stuff. And it's just kind of like, yeah, what would be your purpose is what I think of. What is your quality of life? What is the day-to-day, you know, if you are stuck in this room by yourself that you cannot leave, with nobody else around you, no way to contact anybody because they're all dead or monsters. And I guess it kind of made me think, like, especially when I was like, yeah, I would kill my second or my other self if they were going to be stuck here like this, because I wouldn't want that. So I don't think she would want that
and
either.
And who would know better than you?
Yeah, exactly. And I feel like that's one of those things that you can make that choice for yourself, and then the game makes you make these choices for others
right
as you go through.
That's why, so I don't think, like, you can get the Simon question wrong. I think the Simon question is, whatever you would do is what they would want you to do.
Yeah. And so I guess it's talking about the theory of living, but then also, like, what specifically being a human and being alive means. Like, what as a human do you find important? If you aren't in your physical body, can you still find fulfillment? Does that still feel... There's a questionnaire that the game has in the game that is, like, for people who are in the simulation that is, like, how do you feel about this? Do you feel like you're really disconnected? Do you feel like you're a stranger in your own body? Is this scary to you? Do you hate it?
Like, are you mourning your lost self, or are you excited for a new adventure? So good.
Yeah. Especially because it's also about, like, how do you carry on, you know, when everything's gone, too? Like, can you put your past, like, physical self behind and kind of, like, focus on the future?
Oh, I always
especially because in this game you have Simon sacrifice himself, like, twice, essentially, so that a version of himself can go on. So it's kind of like, maybe if he was a different person, he wouldn't be able to do that. And you kind of see that perspective from a lot of the other characters in the game. And I think it's interesting to think about it philosophically in that sense, like in concept and also personally to you, what you would do in the situation or how you feel about it.
Well, and then also something that was kind of coming up for me a lot was this idea of parenthood and how that plays into it, how this, like, the splitting of yourself is not dissimilar than becoming a parent. And, like, the ending is of the game that I love, when he's left alone, is not dissimilar from, like, the Superman story, right? He has put himself, his the extenuation of himself into a vessel and sent it into the stars. This idea that, like, I would be super stoked for my child to survive the apocalypse, but for another me to survive the apocalypse would be different. Like, I wouldn't see those things as different. Yeah. I'd be like, great. I'm on board with this. I'm so happy for everybody that's involved here.
Yeah. I mean, I can only think about it conceptually because I do not have children and don't necessarily plan on ever having any, but theoretically thinking about that, a child is like a completely different person from yourself, but they are connected to you. They're someone who you've like invested your hopes and expectations or like love into, you know. I feel like it's a lot easier in some cases to love something separate from yourself or something exactly like yourself in this case where it is just a copy of yourself.
Yeah.
Which I think people are going to react to that differently.
Yeah. Did you have any other thoughts on what the big question this game was asking was?
I mean, it's essentially like what we've been talking about. Nothing really in addition, but I feel like it's such a loaded, like I said, philosophical question that we could just keep talking about, that we could make a whole series of podcasts on this and concept alone.
Subscribe to our Patreon for more up our own asshole conversations about the philosophy of being alive.
Exactly.
Roxy, let's talk about how likely we think this is to be real. Between 1 and 9, because there's those are the numbers that are possible.
Number 10 does not exist.
I got into my head about it. I was like, do we talk about how 10 doesn't exist if 10 doesn't exist? But the point is, no, 10 doesn't exist.
Yeah, it doesn't exist. We can say its name, but that's it.
How likely is this scenario to be real? How likely is it to come true? I'll tell you my answer.
Okay,
it's not just 9. It's 11. It's one higher than 9. Because it almost for sure already happened. It is all. I am so confident that this game scenario or something like it has occurred. No way has it not.
Like in the history of the universe or the history of humanity?
We're in the arc, Roxy. We are the arc.
Oh, I see. I gotcha.
It just feels like so obvious that they're like on an endless timeline. The idea that we never put our consciousness into a computer and shot it into space. That's ridiculous to me.
I mean, that's one of the theories, right? The simulation theory?
So 100%.
Who knows? If so, I'd like to speak to the programmers because we've had a pretty shitty, more than 2 years, but in particular, these 2 years.
Oh, yeah. They've been asleep at the wheel.
Like to speak to a
wheel.
Manager.
They're like the developers of Square Enix's Avengers game. They're just like, we delayed the story DLC. It'll come through at some point. But for now, just keep doing the same repetitive things in the one location we've rendered until you die of boredom. And it's like, I guess I will. I don't know if that game's good. I haven't played it.
I have no idea either, but that concept alone hits hard with it being quarantined still and people trapped inside with winter storms and all. I'd say for me, it's kind of hard. I'd say, like, in Soma, they've damaged the planet a ton. It's one of the reasons why the base is underwater. And also, they talk about how the world is kind of, like, fucked up. So I feel like, definitely, we're gonna... Too many people in charge make bad decisions, at least right now. I'd love to be wrong about this. To, like, save our environment at the expense of getting paid. So I feel like, definitely, we'll destroy our planet. And sure, a comet would come and hit us, but... I don't know if I have enough confidence in the fact that we would ever be able to come up with brain scan tech like this before we make ourselves extinct. So,
Roxy, you just made the first ever convincing argument for me to be on Team Comet.
Team Comet.
I was like,
right?
Who am I rooting for here? Sorry, what was your number?
So I'm going to say a 4, because I'd say, like, I don't believe that we'd be able to do the brain scan tech before we become extinct. So that's why it's not a 5. So it's less than half for me.
All right, Roxy, what do you say we escape from this scary basement?
Okay, I'm so ready to get out of here.
If there is a monster, I will do like a little duck and weave. I'll be like, oh, I'm going left, I'm going left, I'm going left. Ooh, ooh.
Okay, maybe while you're distracting him, I can hit him with like this 2x4 that's over here.
Okay, you ready?
That worked? Okay.
Here we go.
3, 2, 1.